I'm back. What's up, Tampa Bay? I hope everybody is taking initiative, moving forward, and you're ready to rumble in the baseball jungle because baseball is back, baby. I'm Chuck Turgeon, the most hype man you will meet on the street, here to get you in the know about tonight's show. Tonight, Michael will be talking about the return of baseball and what the changes made due to the coronavirus mean to both fans and players. Michael will also be discussing entrepreneurship and leadership with the CEO of Tampa Bay Wave. Aero Environmental Services will be giving us the lowdown on the showdown with roaches. And finally, our friend Sam the Movie Man will give us a sneak peek at Palm Springs. And now, for your host, the always fantastic, Michael Clayton!
Welcome to Michael Clayton Live. I am so happy you're joining me again today for another entertaining show. Now, you obviously see me wearing my mask, which is something I want to discuss today. Now, I'll take my mask off so that you can hear me a little bit better since my crew is wearing their mask because their safety is important to me. So why have we made mask wearing a political situation?
You're 6 feet away from you.
You're harassing me.
I'm not harassing you. You are infecting us. You're coming close to me.
Back off!
Businesses like Costco, which are privately owned, I should remind you, have the right to decide whether they require you to enter their establishment with a mask on. Now, guess what? If you don't want to wear a mask, then don't go to that privately owned business. It's pretty simple. This is about respect. It's about respecting other people who may be elderly or have compromised immune systems who have to go out and shop for food and medicine, and they will feel safe and are safer if everyone is wearing a mask.
I work for Costco and I'm asking this member to put on a mask because that is our company policy. So either wear the mask or...
And I'm not doing it because I woke up in a free country. There he is walking away with all my stuff. There he goes. Because I'm not a f***ing sheep.
It's not about you being called a sheep if you wear a mask. It's about being called a jackass if you don't. Come on, America. We can do better than that. Or can we? Because I'm sure you've heard by now, Kanye West spoke to Forbes and he says he's running for president. Wait. Is this script right? President of what? Sunday service? The Republican Rap Coalition?
Michael, Kanye's running for president of the free world.
Who Kanye gonna beat?
Well, he did beat COVID.
He did beat COVID. Man, president of the free world. Who's free world? Wayne's World? Party time! Excellent! The crazy thing is that Kanye is not running for the 2024 election, no. Wait for it. He's running for 2020. For an election that's less than 4 months away. It would be the black candidate that's late. We have the Republican Party, the Democratic Party, the Independent Party, and because of Kanye West, we have the birthday party. Go Kanye, it's your birthday, it's my birthday, it's our birthday. No, it's not. And lastly, there's an important disclaimer. Kanye West is running for president, but no paperwork has been filed. But if he's able to run, let's be positive, because this could be the start of black privilege. Let's get the show started.
Your quality of life is impacted by pests trying to make your home their home.
At Aero Environmental Services, we keep your family and pets safe from unwanted pests. To learn more, visit aeroservices.com and schedule your free total home pest evaluation today.
Aero Environmental Services provides effective pest control that improves your quality of life so you can truly relax and enjoy yourself with friends and family.
My first guest needs no introduction if you watch the Tampa Bay Rays on Sun Sports. Not only did he play with the New York Yankees, Pittsburgh Pirates, and Florida Marlins, but he even played for the Cebu Lions in Japan, where he was inducted into their Hall of Fame in 1994. But you'll still find him at the ballparks as a co-host of Rays Live pre- and post-game analysis, clutching his baseball, Julio. Some call him Orestes Destrada, but to me, he's my big friend, the Big O. Welcome, Big O.
You know it, Michael. MC, it's good to be here. My pleasure. Congratulations on the show, and I think it's a testament to your hard work, not only on the field, but now off the field, and bringing a good product to the local people here.
Well, it's all a success because people the likes of yourself joining me to, you know, clear the airways and feed the people with some information.
A lot going on.
Man. So baseball, the Baseball Players Union, and the owners finally came to an agreement about how they want to kind of, you know, get a season started due to COVID. It kind of stopped everything, you know, all sports really.
Sure.
You know, it's everything stopped in March, which is like at the height of spring training.
Right.
Now it's a 60-day game plan. How do you think that this is all going
to
plan out?
Well, you know, Michael, initially this was one of the difficult sports to navigate through COVID because they were just starting. They were in the infancy of spring training. All of a sudden, boom, shut down. I will say that it took a little longer than expected because of the business of sports. But they're all going to take a lick. They're all going to take, you know, a hit as you know, most of America is, but they're back out there, and I've been out to the trap, and everybody's very encouraged. And one of the things that I'm noticing, especially because of our team, we have so many young players, they're hungry to bring the product, just say, America, here it is. And hopefully, Lord willing, you know, there won't be too many hiccups to preclude that.
Well, we knew that it was going to be tragic to all sports when COVID shuts down NASCAR, you know?
right.
But of all sports, you know, baseball, you're already social distancing on the field.
Right.
Do you feel like it will be easier for baseball to kind of come back opposed to the other sports who have probably, you know, more numbers, there are more proximity,
correct.
You know, it's a contact sport, even basketball is more contact a little bit. Is it easier for baseball to come back?
That's a great point because no doubt in basketball, you got to push soccer, your sport, you know, you're getting hammered, especially in the trenches. So that is a great question. I think it will be. And they already have, you know, an example of that because both the Japanese league and the Korean leagues a month ago already restarted. They've had good success with how they've handled COVID. And they started up and so far so good. They've had a handful of players that have gone down. And they've replaced them. And that's the system that MLB has in place now. You're going to have a 30-man roster to start, and you're going to have a 60-man, another 30 guys down in Port Charlotte. Every team's going to send to a local area their backups. So if one goes down, next man up.
Next man up. So this is going to affect all sports, and it's the fans in the stands. You know, and some teams are used to not having fans.
Right. Yeah. We kind of social distance already. We've been doing that for a few years in the trap. Not on TV, though.
Not on TV.
We got a great following.
How do you think that that's going to affect the players, if it's going to affect them at all, with possibly no fans being in the stands?
Here's an interesting thing, MC, about baseball. And you being, you know, I know you played more than just football. But with football, ever since you were in high school, Friday Night Lights, packed, right? Packed. But you had your baseball friends,
right?
We played at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. We didn't have any fans.
Right.
We had the parents.
13, yeah, parents.
Right. Unless you went to a mad big boy college,
you
went to a JC or a, no fans again. You're playing afternoon. Baseball has never been notoriously that the elite nighttime sport, right? So you go into the minor leagues, very little fans. The one interesting thing about baseball is that we're accustomed to not playing fans. Football, I don't think so. I mean, it's gonna be dramatic. I hope that at least they give them a quarter of a state. You know, let's say at 80,000, they give them 20 and spread them out.
I was saying simulated noise.
Yeah. Well, you know what? Here's the thing. We grew up, you know, with Cheers and Friends and I Love Lucy.
Yeah.
That's all made up laughter anyway. Whenever they make a joke, I was telling that to my brother recently. I go, somebody hits on. It has to work because we're going to have to play like that for a minute. And then I'm hoping that hopefully by the playoffs, you know, there's some scenario that some fandom can be allowed in. And when you speak of playoffs, I'm expecting the Rays to be in it.
Speaking of scenario, so when I played with the New York Giants, it was the year of the lockout. We had a veteran team.
Yep.
So we were able to navigate those waters. We end up winning a Super Bowl the next year. Do you think that the shortened season can affect certain teams in a positive way or a negative way? Is it going to be an even playing field across the Major League Baseball?
One of the things, and you know the different seasons and knowing crossover friends and athletes, baseball is notoriously a marathon. I mean, it is 8 months of spring training until 8 months if you make it to the playoffs and you're playing in October, 7 months if not. But it's 162 games, 30 spring training games. But by the time you're done, you've played 200 games, right? You're beat, man. And that's where the injuries come. It's not from that you're banging into people. It's just the everyday grind. So this is no marathon. This is a sprint, a full-on sprint. You lose 10 games in a row, you're done in this one. You can't do that. So I think that it's going to help certain teams. A team like San Diego, I was studying the other day, they can be very sneaky. A team like the Mets. I mean, these teams would not be in contention and considered. The Mets could be sneaky. Toronto could be sneaky. Again, I think that the ones to really truly consider are New York, are the Rays. Teams like Washington is strong again, but there's that little, you know, tweener. Atlanta is not really a tweener, but they're a team that could just ride you. And I think the key is youth, staying healthy, both injuries and COVID, but it's youth. It's
interesting.
The gumption right now. It's the ones that are really playing the game almost as a kid. Yeah. You know what I mean? Right. Because you get the veterans and they're like, this sucks. This sucks. And you know this game at that level, Michael. You let up a little bit, and you don't think you're letting up.
You can't make up for it.
They got you.
Yep.
And the ball gets by you, or the guy intercepts it, and you're like, "What the heck happened? I didn't make that step."
Well, I appreciate you taking the time to spend some time with us, and I know that the fans appreciate you letting go of Mr. Julio.
Julio right here, man, came to visit, and yes, I said yes to the Michael Clayton Show. You know, and I tell you what, where am I? Over here. I really definitely want to say, man, because the community is so important. You know, we got, and I know you are, and I am, as far as being so thankful about being blessed. But these are the type of shows that can do and bring people together. Not only bring good news, good tidings, you know, and promote, but also support.
Thanks,
you know it, brother. My pleasure.
Up next, I sit down with the president and CEO of Tampa Bay Wave, Linda Olson, to see how they are helping startup tech companies right here in Tampa Bay. You stay with us.
The reason I came to Trinity Dental Arts is because my mouth was in horrible shape. It is a long drive here from Kissimmee, but was most impressed with what I saw. Dr. G's credentials, the training that she'd had. Every person in this office made me feel very comfortable.
And then by the time they walk out, you have a different person. And to see that over and over again is so fulfilling.
Business entrepreneurship is what this country was built upon, but the road can often be filled with unexpected detours, roadblocks, and even dead ends. Here in Tampa Bay is a local nonprofit that was founded in 2008 as just a meetup group for local tech entrepreneurs. Tampa Bay Wave is a 501c3 that supports 100 startups a year and is trying to make Tampa Bay a nationally recognized tech hub. And I am joined by President and CEO, Ms. Linda Olson. Thank you so much for joining us today. Ms. Linda, can you tell me a little bit about Tampa Bay Wave and the mission and why it's so important to our local communities?
Sure. Well, at the heart of our mission is really about driving opportunity and prosperity right here in our community. We do that by helping local tech entrepreneurs build thriving, scalable, big businesses here. And the more of them that can survive, the bigger our tech community can be here. And why does that matter? Because tech companies create high-wage jobs, lots of them, and they tend to be recession-proof too. If we can build the next Facebook, the next Uber, the next Google right here in Tampa Bay, we can have lots of jobs. And certainly with the unemployment situation we have going on right now, jobs is a big topic these days.
Absolutely. And speaking of jobs and unemployment, much of which has been caused by COVID, what has been that impact that COVID has played on the tech community and for the startup community?
Yeah, well, we certainly had some companies that were definitely negatively impacted by COVID. Almost overnight, some of their markets just evaporated, especially those startups like in hospitality. But we also had other companies that really like benefited, and I hate to say that, because of COVID, but they found new markets and new applications for their technology. And in some cases, their technology was nice to have, and now it's necessary because of COVID. Right. We had one founder, entrepreneur, who was a veteran, and he started a business a little over a year ago to help get prescription drugs delivered to his home in a more timely manner, right? So it's called MedZoomer. It's great. But he was really only getting traction with locally owned pharmacies, you know, the smaller ones, until COVID hit. Now he's got national companies reaching out to him because they see his service is now necessary. Yeah.
And being at the times that we're living in today, obviously quality and diversity is a huge topic. And just going on the website, you guys are on the forefront of making sure that you're educating businesses. Yeah. That diversity is a key component. Speak to those businesses. How important do you see diversity playing in the role of entrepreneurship? How can that impact in a positive way any business that chooses to add diversity to their components?
Well, we've been running our diversity theme programs for over 3 years now. So it's not just a response to the topic of the day, so to speak, right? We've been a long time believer that, you know, you need representation of diverse founders. It helps companies build better businesses. When they have diverse management teams, they can think about the diverse customers that they serve better, right? So it makes stronger companies. There's data out there that shows diverse teams outperform their peers that are not diverse. So it makes actually good business, right? But it's also more than just a social good. I think there's also an economic imperative that's going on in this country. If we have more people participating in the economy, right? It helps lift all boats. We all grow the economy. And by the way, those folks who come from those underrepresented groups take those benefits back to the communities they come from. So it has a ripple effect.
Absolutely. So someone is starting their new business. They need funds to get started. How do they reach out to you? How do they contact you to get that help that they need to push them forward?
Our website right now is tampabaywave.org. We are taking applications right now for our women-themed accelerator program. So if anybody out there knows of a woman working on a business, particularly if it has a tech angle, we'd encourage them to reach out to us. But anyone can reach out.
Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
When we come back, Bob Wilgus is back in the studio to talk about that bug I just hate, roaches, when we come back.
Honey, look at our neighbors. They're out in their backyard again, barbecuing with friends, and their kids are playing outside.
They use Aero Environmental Services. I would love to go out in our yard more, but every time we do, we get eaten alive by mosquitoes and the kids get bit by fire ants.
Maybe we should call Aero Environmental Services too.
If you want to take back your yard from unwanted pests, contact the folks at Aero Environmental Services Pest Control. With same-day service in most areas, you can start enjoying a pest-free lifestyle tomorrow.
Welcome back to Michael Clayton Live. Listen, guys, I am a grown man. I fear nothing except cockroaches. Cockroaches that run, cockroaches that fly, even cockroaches that are laying dead on their back. They're just nasty. And nobody wants to talk about roaches, but if you have them, you need to talk to somebody. Joining me again is our friend from Aero Environmental Services, Bob Wilgus. He's here to tell us how to never come in contact with cockroaches ever again. Bob, thank you for joining
us. Glad to be here.
I asked you to bring me some facts, but you also brought me a science project, man. What do you have for me?
So in the time we've been together, you've been pretty clear that the cockroach is your least favorite
crystal.
Pet.
Crystal.
I didn't want to bring you just the samples of the two most common ones in the greater Tampa Bay area, which are German and American. So I thought I'd bring you this.
I appreciate it.
Nice little science project.
The whole family.
So this is a basic overview of some of the most common cockroaches in the area. The ones that we deal with most are the American and the German cockroach. And so we're going to talk a little bit about how they live, feed, and breed, and maybe we can, I don't know if we'll get into the depths of your fear of them, but
well, we'll
did you want to?
We'll go as deep as we need to go. And as I'm looking at it, I mean, it's cockroaches are kind of like people, many different races and different types. I mean,
that's exactly right.
Would you know what a person, average Joe, would they know what type of cockroaches are terrorizing their kitchen pantries?
You know, most people wouldn't. You know, people can Google all this kind of stuff and see if they can identify it. But at the end of the day, one of the great things about the services we provide is we can come to your house, put in a trap, and our specialist will come out and he'll know exactly what kind of cockroach it is and how to treat it. And I think some of the things that you and I spoke about that we want to come right out front and say is cockroaches don't live only in dirty houses. You can have the cleanest house. You can be just really focused on cleanliness. Cockroaches live, feed, and breed in dark, warm places. They can also lay eggs on traveling containers like cardboard boxes. And so you may have the cleanest house. You bring in that Amazon box, plop it on your kitchen table. Next thing you know, little eggs have gone into the sink underneath. And two to 4 weeks later, you've got cockroaches coming out from underneath your sink or underneath your stove or refrigerator. So treating them is something we do every single day. But there's a huge difference between treating them with over-the-counter stuff and what we do.
And so today I wanted to kind of dive into some facts. Because
right.
If you're out there and you're thinking about a DIY cockroach eradication,
yep.
Okay, when you hear about some of these facts about roaches, and I swear I would compare it to a ninja, all right? Yeah. These are some impressive little scary little bugs, all right? You just might want to think about calling Arrow after you hear about some of these facts. A cockroach can breathe for 40 minutes submerged underwater.
So how many times have you been around people that, and no, this isn't necessarily kitchen conversation, but someone will take, you know, a paper towel, they'll grab the cockroach, they'll throw it in the toilet, and they'll flush it down, and they'll think, that's it, it's gone. Well, if it didn't go all the way down, it's coming back out. And by the way, it needs water to live, feed, and breed. So if you haven't really crushed it, like you've shared with us that you've done on occasion, that's just one of those things. You just can't drown a cockroach. So it's the treatment of it's a little bit different than just flushing it down the toilet.
Yeah, well, we talked in the inaugural show about, you know, I had a one or two encounters with a few roaches, and I said, man, you made me feel happy because you said the problem is probably coming from the Amazon Prime boxes.
Correct.
You made me feel real comfortable. But then after speaking with you, you also tell me that if you have one,
that's true,
you might have 100. Oh, my goodness.
And we can tell you stories and show you pictures where we pull a refrigerator out and pull the insulation back, and they're just loaded, but they only saw the one. So, again, if you see one, you've got a lot more.
Well, listen, no need to fear. Arrow is here. You give them a call, they will come handle all of your problems.
True.
And until they show up at your door, get a nanny cam and it'll record all of your nighttime friends who come out at nighttime. Maybe that'll give you some motivation to contact Arrow as soon as possible.
Well, on our site that you're going to tell them about, they could actually take a picture of a bug and upload it. So if they go to the page on our website, we can take a look at that as well.
Well, if you have any questions for them, you can go to arrowservices.com/Michael to send them your questions or suggestions of what we can talk about on another episode that maybe can give you some more information and help you out right here on Michael Clayton Live. Don't go away. We will be right back.
Check us out on Facebook, Instagram, and to see expanded interviews, subscribe to our YouTube channel at Michael Clayton Live.
When I was growing up, my mom was extremely tidy. We were trained to put things back where we got them from. One day, when I walked into my mom's house, I felt like I walked to someone else's house. There was stuff everywhere. And just growing up, the way I grew up, and to see this transition was very alarming.
When Sean talked to me, it was a wake-up call, and that's when I went to the doctor.
Our entertainment correspondent Sam Hollenbeck is back this week to share with us a new romantic comedy where an unlikely pair meet at a Palm Springs wedding only to get stuck in a time loop. Let's check it out.
It's going to be a beautiful wedding.
It sure will. And in the course of attending a desert wedding in Palm Springs, young Niles and maid of honor Sarah will find themselves repeating that beautiful morning again and again. And again.
Nice.
Sandberg and Kristen Milioti star in a darkly comedic time tunnel yo-yo of a tale called Palm Springs.
What? It's gonna be a beautiful wedding.
With J.K. Simmons as the dark-souled combatant who's got them on the run.
Guess you followed me. It's one of those infinite time loop situations you might have heard about.
That I might have heard about?
Yeah.
Congratulations on this film. I absolutely loved it. You know what? I think it's fun, dark, diversionary comedy, and I think it's just what the nation needs right now. Do you agree with me?
We certainly hope so. That's very kind of you.
The second you fall asleep, it all just goes back to the start.
You know, I think a lot of people are going to make comparisons to Groundhog Day. I think it's more like a dark Twilight Zone in a way, or kind of a funny, darkly comedic Twilight Zone. Would either of you guys agree with that?
Oh, absolutely. I think it's very, very sci-fi.
See you tomorrow.
Were you a fan of Twilight Zone when you were back in the day?
Oh, Rod Serling just scared the bejesus out of me, as my dad would have said. I watched it like this, you know, big fan, but like really, really scared.
What's the first episode when you think of the Twilight Zone? You know, I always think of Rod Serling sitting there smoking a cigarette and doing those intros that he did. But everybody sort of has one episode that they think of as the go-to that really got him. What was yours?
Well, my big one wasn't even like all that scary, but it was the Burgess Meredith where he all he wanted to do was read, and then there was, you know, and then everyone on the planet was, you know, killed except him, and he was in the library, and you know, he got his wish, but then his glasses broke and he couldn't read anymore. You know, the tragic irony.
Kristen, there's one scene that I think about where Andy takes a bow and arrow, an arrow into the shoulder, and you let out a blood-curdling scream. Yeah. I mean, it is a scream of death. And I got to wonder, what does it feel like to let it all rip and just know that that's the right take?
I mean, you hope it's the right take. I never know. I'm sort of someone like, as soon as they yell action, I sort of like black out. So I don't know in the moment, but like that whole sequence was so much fun to shoot.
Weirdest thing that happened on the set for you?
Sandstorm?
The sandstorm, that was wild.
We're shooting, like basically had to like cover ourselves up with blankets and get like pelted with the sandstorm.
I have a video on my phone of like the crew working on the car rig, and everyone's like, it's like an old Chaplin movie where they're like trying to like get to it, like being blown back, and everyone has like goggles on. It was crazy.
Palm Springs premieres this weekend on Hulu and in select drive-ins nationwide. For Michael Clayton Live, I'm Sam Hallenbeck.